Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How are you all doing? Alhamdulillah. Nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihi al-kareem. Amma ba'd fa'a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri. Wahlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Allahumma ihdi qalbi wasaddid lisani waslul sakhimata qalbi. Juz number 30, Surah An-Naba.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amma yatasaalun. 'Anil Naba'il 'Azim. Alladhi hum fihi mukhtalifun. Kalla sayalamun. Thumma kalla sayalamun.
Surah An-Naba. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amma yatasaalun. 'Anil Naba'il 'Azim. Alladhi hum fihi mukhtalifun. About what are they asking one another? About the great news, meaning the Day of Judgment, that over which they are in disagreement. They differ amongst themselves about the Day of Judgment. Each one says something different. Some say there is no resurrection. Others say it will be like a dream. Some have a completely different conception. Allah says, Kalla sayalamun. No, they are going to know. Thumma kalla sayalamun. Then no, they are going to know. That time is not far when it will come before them as a reality. And all their assumptions will fizzle away before them. Now, Allah mentions different signs of His creation as proofs of resurrection. That the Lord who has made this once, this creation once, He can also recreate the creation whenever He wants. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Have we not made the earth a resting place, and the mountains as stakes, as pegs, holding the earth in place? And we created you in pairs, and made your sleep a means for rest. And made the night as clothing, and made the day for livelihood, and constructed above you seven strong skies, and made therein a burning lamp, the sun, and sent down from the rain clouds pouring water, that we may bring forth thereby grain and vegetation, and gardens of entwined growth. There was a time when none of this existed. The sun didn't exist. The sky didn't exist. The earth didn't exist. We didn't exist. Where did all of this come from? Allah made it. Allah created it. So when He created it once, can He not recreate it? Yes, He can. إِنَّ يَوْمَ الْفَصْلِ كَانَ مِيقَاتًا. Indeed, the Day of Judgment is an appointed time. That is when the entire creation will be resurrected. How will this resurrection begin? The day the horn is blown, and you will come forth in multitudes. And the heaven is opened and will become gateways. And the mountains are removed and will be but a mirage. Indeed, hell has been lying in wait. For the transgressors, a place of return in which they will remain for ages unending. Jahannam is waiting, seeking the criminals, that when they will be within its reach, so it can take them in. And once it takes them in, their coming out is impossible. They will not taste therein any coolness or drink, except scalding water and foul purulence, an appropriate recompense. جَزَاءً وِفَاقًا. Why is it an account, a recompense that is appropriate? How is it befitting? Because indeed they were not expecting an account. and denied our verses with emphatic denial, with absolute denial. But all things we have enumerated in writing, so taste the penalty, and never will we increase you except in torment. But إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازًا, indeed for the righteous is attainment. That day they shall attain. What is it that they will attain? Whatever they want, whatever they desire. حَدَائِقَ وَأَعْنَابًا, gardens and grapevines, and full-breasted companions of equal age, and a full cup, no ill speech will they hear therein, or any falsehood. This is why whoever wishes to go to Jannah, then what is it that he needs to avoid? Lagh and kidhab, lying and useless things. Because lying is something that prevents a person from truthfulness. It leads a person to sin, and sin leads a person to hell. And lagh, useless, vain speech, all of this is something that destroys the precious moments of life that Allah has given to a person so that he may earn Jannah. So a person who wants to go to Jannah, then he must abstain from lagh and kidhab. جَزَاءً مِّن رَبِّكَ عَطَاءً حِسَابًا, as reward from your Lord, a generous gift made due by account. Meaning yes, they brought deeds, and yes, they were held accountable, and yes, Allah rewarded them with more than they deserved. A generous gift from the Lord of the heavens and the earth and whatever is between them. Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. La yamlikuna minhu khitaba, they possess not from him authority for speech. Meaning none can speak in his presence without his permission. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفَّى, the day that the spirit, meaning the angel Jibreel, and the rest of the angels also, will stand in rows. They will not speak except for one whom the Most Merciful permits, and he will say what is correct. Meaning none will intercede for another. No person will make a request for another person. No angel even can do that, except with the permission of Allah. And also we see here, لا يتكلمون, people will not even speak to each other. They will not even comfort each other verbally. They will not even help each other in any way. We learn in a hadith, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrated, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, on the day of resurrection, people will proceed in groups and they will fall on their knees. And when we think about they, let's picture us in the people on the day of judgment, because we will also be there. They will fall on their knees and every nation will follow their prophet and will say, oh so and so, meaning oh prophet of ours, intercede for us with Allah, meaning do something for us. Until intercession shall be given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that will be the day when Allah will raise him into a station of praise and glory, maqamun mahmud. So he will fall prostrate, glorifying and praising Allah, and then he will be granted permission to intercede, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam shall intercede only after Allah's permission. What we learn from this is that no one can intercede himself. No one can speak himself. No one can advocate anything for himself. Nobody at all. This is why all of us should be concerned about ourselves today. We need to worry about our actions today. Because sometimes we think so-and-so will help us on the day of judgment. But the reality is that no one will help you if Allah does not allow, if Allah is not happy with us. So our entire effort in life should be to please Allah. Because even the prophets of Allah, what will they say? Rabbi, sallim, sallim. Oh Allah, protect us, save us, save us. No person will be concerned about another. We need to do our best to please Allah. So Allah will rescue us that day. ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ الْحَقِّ, that is the true day. فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ مَآبًا, so he who wills may take to his Lord a way of return. Whoever wants, he can choose the path that will take him to Allah. Indeed, we have warned you of a near punishment on the day when a man will observe what his hands have put forth. And the disbeliever will say, "Oh, I wish that I were dust." Because when he will see his deeds, he will see nothing that is worth any weight on the Day of Judgment. And he will wish that I had been turned to dust after death and never resurrected. But the fact is that Allah will resurrect everyone. And everyone will be recompensed for what he has done. Surah An-Nazi'at.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. والنازعات غرقا والناشطات نشطا والسابحات سبحا السابقات سبقا المدبرات أمرا يوم ترجف الراجفة تتبعها الرادفة قلوب يومئذ واجفة أبصارها خاشعة
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والنازعات غرقا والناشطات نشطا والسابحات سبحا فالسابقات سبقا فالمدبرات أمرا يوم ترجف الراجفة تتبعها الرادفة قلوب يومئذ واجفة. By those angels who extract with violence, meaning the soul of a human being, they pull out the soul from every hair and every nerve of the body. And by those who remove with ease, meaning other souls, they take out so smoothly that those nearby do not even know that the soul of the deceased has already departed. And by those who glide as if swimming, meaning the angels, they move so swiftly. And those who race each other in a race, the angels race in obeying Allah as if competing with one another. And those who arrange each matter, meaning the angels who, according to Allah's orders, they precisely do what they have been commanded. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ Allah says, on the day, the blast of the horn will convulse the creation. But this will not be just one convulsion. تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّاجِفَةِ They will follow it the subsequent one. One blast, one blowing of the trumpet will be followed by another blowing of the trumpet. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ Hearts that day will tremble. Anytime we hear a loud noise, it frightens us. But the blowing of the trumpet is a sound that we cannot even imagine right now. أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشِعَةٌ Their eyes will be humbled, meaning people will be extremely scared because of their bad outcome. On the contrary, Allah's friends will be under His throne, under His shade, peaceful, secure, fear-free, worry-free. Fearless. يقولون أئنا لمردودون في الحافرة But right now, those who deny, what do they say? They say, will we indeed be returned to our former state of life? How is that possible? Even if we should be decayed bones, when our bones have become brittle and hollow, still we will be resurrected? They say, that then would be a losing return. Meaning, what a big loss that would be. Indeed, it will be but one shout. And suddenly, they will be alert upon the earth's surface. One shout they will hear, and everyone will arrive at the place that they are supposed to. هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى Has there reached you the story of Musa? When his Lord called to him in the sacred valley of Tuwa, saying, Go to Fir'aun, indeed he has transgressed, and say to him, Would you be willing to purify yourself? And let me guide you to your Lord, so you would fear him? This is the way of conveying Allah's religion. Filling the hearts of Allah's servants with fear of Allah, His awe. So that the servant is directly connected to who? To his Lord. And on this, we must analyze ourselves also. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَىٰ The sign of accepting guidance is that a person develops خَشْيَةٌ خَشْيَةٌ of who? Of Allah Azza wa Jal. So here we need to check ourselves that on reading the Qur'an, on reflecting on the meanings of the Qur'an, have we developed the fear of Allah? If we have not, and if we are the way we were before, then the purpose has not been fulfilled. Then this would have been a useless effort. Because the intended result is fatakhsha. It should be that a person develops fear of Allah. But as long as we are alive, we have a chance that we strive to develop Allah's fear, and we ask Allah also to grant us His khashya, His khawf, His taqwa. And the purpose of Ramadan is also the development of taqwa. So Fir'aun, Musa alayhi salam showed him the greatest signs, but Fir'aun denied and disobeyed. Then he turned his back, striving, plotting to conspire against Musa alayhi salam, because he sensed Musa alayhi salam as a threat to himself. And he gathered his people, and he called out, he made an announcement to reassure his people so that they don't get affected by Musa alayhi salam. What did he say? Fir'aun said, "I am your most exalted Lord." So Allah seized him in exemplary punishment for the last and the first transgression. Meaning Allah punished him in dunya and in akhirah. And also in the barzakh we learn that the people of Fir'aun, they are put to fire morning and evening. And on the day of judgment, much more awaits them for the leader and for his followers. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. Indeed in that is a warning for whoever would fear. Who? Do we consider ourselves as those who fear Allah? InshaAllah, if we don't, then let us fear Allah right now. Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. There is a lesson in this for he who fears Allah. What is that lesson? That cast out any pride from your heart, any feeling of self-exaltation. Because this kind of pride and ego, this is what leads to Fir'auniyyah. And what is that? Such pride that a person sees the truth, recognizes it, but he doesn't accept it. So we should ask Allah to make us humble and to remove from our hearts any pride, even if it is a little bit. Because on the Day of Judgment, none can enter Jannah with pride. Are you a more difficult creation? Or is the heaven a more difficult creation? Allah constructed it, meaning the sky that you see above you. Who made it? Who built it? Allah built it. He raised its ceiling and proportioned it. And He darkened its night and extracted its brightness. How amazing, such a massive sky. And in nighttime, completely dark. And without us even knowing, the night turns into day. And after that, He spread the earth. He extracted from it its water and its pasture. And the mountains He set firmly as provision for you, meaning for your life and your grazing livestock. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. The Day of Judgment. الطَّامَّة. Allah says, when that will come, then when the tammah will come. Tammah is such a calamity that does not go away, that cannot be pushed away, that cannot be averted. There is absolutely no escape from it. And the terrors of the Day of Judgment will be so widespread that they'll be never ending, inescapable. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. When the greatest tammah, when the greatest calamity shall come. The day when man will remember that for which he strove. يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى. On the Day of Judgment, each person will remember what he had been striving for. You and I will remember and think about what is it that we were running after in this world. We will look at what we have done all our lives. Yes, there will be many moments that will cause embarrassment to a person. And this is why it is necessary that we remember our sins now. The forgotten sins, we remember them now. And the opportunities that we neglect, let's seize them now. Because يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى. On the Day of Judgment, a person will not remember the wishes and the goals and the intentions that he made once upon a time, but the effort that he made. And remember, it's the effort, because it's quite possible that a person is striving, but he doesn't make it till the end. Despite his best efforts, he doesn't make it till the end. So what is it that will be looked at? It is the striving. How much is it that a person strove? How much effort did he put in for the sake of Allah? وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَىٰ And hellfire will be exposed for all those who see. So as for he who transgressed and preferred the life of the world, then indeed hellfire will be his refuge. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ But as for he who feared the position of his Lord, the one who fears standing before his Lord, meaning this thought makes him anxious, that I have to stand before Allah, how will I face Him? When He will ask me about my sins, how will I stand before Him? And this fear, he doesn't just have these moments when he's afraid and then he goes back to how he was, but وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ And he prevented the soul from inclination, meaning from the desire. This is the key point. You see, our greatest enemy is sitting inside of us. It's not outside of us. It's sitting inside of us. It is the nafs. Controlling the nafs, stopping the nafs from wrong is the most difficult thing. Just think about it. How difficult is it for you these days to wake up for sahur? How difficult is it? Don't you have to push yourself and throw yourself out of bed? Don't you have to do that? You want to sleep. Isn't it so difficult to control your sleep at that time? And force yourself to get up, leave your sleep and go and eat? Because you know that if you don't eat, how will you survive the day? This is just one example of how difficult it is to control the nafs. And a person who's able to control the nafs, then yes, he is victorious. He is successful. Because it's very easy to advise other people, to convince them, to tell them. What is most difficult is to advise oneself, to tell oneself, to convince oneself. Because you tell yourself, do something or not do something, and the nafs will present 100 excuses. This is why, while we are afraid of shaitan, meaning the threat of shaitan, and we realize the threat of misleading people, we must also realize the bigger threat of the nafs, this enemy which is inside of us. أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ نَفْسِي The Prophet ﷺ made this dua morning and evening. Oh Allah, I seek Your protection from the evil of my soul. Because it's very, very important that we recognize the tricks of the nafs. You know, the nafs also deceives us. It's necessary that we understand the deception of the nafs. How it deceives us. How it leads us astray. You remember the story of Yusuf ﷺ. How his brothers, one conversation in which they expressed their jealousy of their brother, and then they also criticized the priorities of their father, and that one ghibah led to what? So many sins. And what is it that led them to that? It was their nafs, slowly and gradually. Because you know what? Many times the nafs finds pleasure in doing wrong things. I mean, when we're talking bad about somebody else, why is it that we do it? We like to. We like to gossip. We enjoy. We like talking about the faults of other people so that we appear to be very nice and very righteous. The nafs begins to find pleasure in sin. And then one sin leads to another, which leads to another, and a person goes astray like that. So, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ The one who stops, prevents the soul from hawa, from desire. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ This is the person for whom is Jannah. Indeed, paradise will be his refuge. They ask you, O Prophet, about the hour. When is its arrival? In what position are you that you should mention it? Meaning, who are you to know when the day of judgment is to come? to your Lord is its finality. Its final knowledge, its final decision rests with who? Allah alone. You are only a warner for those who fear it. It will be on the day they see it as though they had not remained in the world except for an afternoon or a morning thereof. This is how short life is. But right now, the moments that we're finding pleasure in disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those moments, they seem to be so long. These days, these nights, they seem to be so long. But if you look at your entire existence from the beginning, from when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extracted the soul from Adam alayhi salam, until today when we are alive, and then when we die, and then so many years in the grave, and then eventually the Day of Judgment, the length of which is 50,000 years, and then inshallah going into Jannah, inshallah. I mean, look at this. What is this life then? 40, 50, 60 years, what is this? It's nothing. But right now, what happens to us? We want to enjoy. The long days of fasting, they seem so burdensome. Time seems to go by so slowly. A difficulty, a trial in life does not seem to end. Day after day we're thinking, when is this going to be over? But just remember that no difficulty of this world is like the difficulty of the akhirah. A life full of problems, full of difficulties, of 100 years is nothing compared to the 50,000 years of the Day of Judgment alone. And then the eternity that follows it. Therefore, remember that the worries of this life, they're not real worries. They're not real problems. What is the real problem that we need to worry about, that we really need to be concerned about? It's the worry, it's the problem of the akhirah. Saving ourselves over there. Protecting ourselves on that day. Surah Abasa. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam frowned and he turned away because there came to him the blind man interrupting him. These verses were revealed about the famous companion Abdullah bin Umm Maktum, who was a relative of Khadija radhiallahu anha. He was a cousin of hers. The Prophet ﷺ, when he was in Makkah, this is in the early years, he was once conversing with the elite of Makkah, the chiefs, the wealthy, influential people. And he was deeply engaged in doing da'wah to them. When Ibn Maktum came, and he began asking the Prophet ﷺ questions that were completely off the topic. The Prophet ﷺ felt that he had been interrupted, so he ignored Abdullah bin Maktum. He frowned a little bit because he was upset. He got a little irritated and annoyed. So he frowned and he ignored Abdullah bin Maktum and he continued his conversation with the chiefs who were sitting over there. This is understandable. But Allah did not approve of this behavior in His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was meant to have the most excellent character. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And this is something that we need to reflect over as well. We need to analyze ourselves as well. Because sometimes we frown over little things. Just because somebody is saying something that we do not agree with, we frown. We bring such a huge frown on our face. And this is something that we need to pay attention to. And many times it happens that we don't realize these mistakes. You see over here, who told the Prophet ﷺ about his frown? Allah Azzawajal. Because sometimes when we're frowning, we don't even realize. So ask people who are closest to you, who are your most sincere well-wishers. Tell me where I slip. Tell me where I err. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. But what would make you perceive, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that perhaps he might be purified? Meaning he's asking you, Abdullah bin Maktum, if you were to teach him, he would be purified. You never know, he might benefit from the knowledge that you teach him. Or he may be reminded, and the remembrance would benefit him. In other words, why did you ignore him? Why did you not like him asking you questions? You should have answered him. You should have taught him. Because he was worthy of your attention. You see over here, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He is advocating for Abdullah bin Maktum. Because the real value of a person near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of who? Which person? The person who may be wearing old and tattered clothes, who may have a disability, because Abdullah bin Maktum was actually blind. Allah mentions over here, there came to him a blind man. He may be disabled, he may be poor, but if he believes in Allah and loves Allah and wants to know about how he can please Allah, then this person is worth more attention. Than who? Than those who may be very rich and wealthy and influential, but who don't have faith in Allah. أَمَّا مَنِ اسْتَغْنَى. As for he who thinks himself without need, to him you give attention? And not upon you is any blame if he will not be purified. Meaning, those people who don't want to learn, you're still paying attention to them. If they don't learn, what's the big deal? It's not going to harm you. Leave them. But those who are eager to learn, why should they be neglected? But as for he who came to you striving, while he fears Allah, from him you are distracted? Don't be distracted from him. Such a person has value near Allah. Now look at yourself, analyze yourself in these ayat. Who is it that has value near Allah? The one who? أَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى. The one who goes running, hastening, eager to learn, eager to find out, to improve his condition. And he fears Allah. Such a person has value near Allah. But the person who turns away, thinking he doesn't need Allah, he doesn't need Allah's book in his life, then why should you waste your time running after such people? Pay attention to those who are eager to learn. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكِرَةٌ. No, indeed, these verses are a reminder. So whoever wills may remember. He may accept this reminder. It is recorded in honored sheets, exalted and purified, carried by the hands of messenger angels, noble and dutiful. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَهُ. Cursed is man. How disbelieving is he? How very, very ungrateful he is. What gives him the right to be ungrateful? From what substance did Allah create him? From a sperm drop He created him and destined for him? Meaning at least look at your origin. What makes you so arrogant? Then He eased the way for him. Meaning Allah gave man strength, the ability to move around, to walk around, to eat and drink, to learn, to communicate, to travel. And like this, he goes through life. But all of these strengths and abilities came from who? Allah. Then He causes his death and provides a grave for him. Meaning eventually this person will die. And where is it that he will be buried? أَقْبَرَ. Allah will select a grave for him. Meaning what Allah has decreed, where a person should be buried, that is where he will be buried. كَلَّا لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَهُ. No, man has not yet accomplished what Allah commanded him. You see, our freedom is only for a few days. Just as long as we are alive. Once we die, then that is it. We cannot move, we cannot get out of the grave. No one can break through the jail of al-qabr, of the grave. And only when Allah intends, will people be resurrected. So in this life, كَلَّا لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَ. What is man doing? Allah says he has not accomplished what Allah commanded him. You know, this is something we need to remember. Because, you know, sometimes when we accomplish a good deed, we think we have done really well. We have kept these many fasts. And inshallah, this many Qur'ans we have recited. And another complete reading of the Qur'an. Allah says, لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَ. No matter how much we have done, we have never done enough. Because remember that if a person were to live his life, his entire life, from the moment his mother gave birth to him, until extreme old age, in which he's not even able to move much, his entire life on earth, if he spent it dragging his face on the ground, pursuing the pleasure of Allah, on the day of judgment, a person will look at this deed and he will say, nothing, not enough. Should have done more, should have done better. كَلَّا لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَهُ. We have never done enough. We have never accomplished enough. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ. Then let mankind look at his food. I mean, just think about it. How much food we've eaten and how many deeds we have performed. Is there any match? Really, is there? No, there isn't. Let mankind look at his food, how we poured down water in torrents. Then we broke open the earth, splitting it with sprouts, and caused to grow within it grain, and grapes, and herbage, and olive, and palm trees, and gardens of dense shrubbery, and fruit, and grass, as enjoyment for you and your grazing livestock. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الصَّاخَّةُ But when there comes the deafening blast of the trumpet, deafening blast, it will overpower every sound. On the day, a man will flee from his brother, and his mother, and his father, and his wife, and his children. So if today they ask us to do something wrong, what should we do? Disobey Allah for their sake? Today, they call you to sin. They might call you. And tomorrow, they will for sure run away from you. For every man that day will be a matter adequate for him. Each person will be worried about himself. So he won't have that capacity to worry about anyone else. But some faces that day will be bright. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ ضَاحِكَةٌ مُسْتَبْشِرَةٌ Laughing, rejoicing at good news. And other faces that day will have upon them dust. Blackness, gloom will cover them. Those are the disbelievers, the wicked ones, those who have spent their lives in disobedience to Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How are you all doing? Alhamdulillah.